I'm dropping cameras all over the Indo-Pacific in search of a species new to science. A few months ago, we did our first deep drop at night and recorded all sorts of strange nocturnal creatures. But one sighting stood out. A brief glimpse of a scalloped hammerhead shark. In this video, we're dropping cameras late into the night to find out what else patrols the ocean floor after dark. And it turns out there's something down there that even the world's top shark expert can't identify. We dropped the first camera in and amongst the rocks at the base of a steep ocean wall. At night, large echinoderms like this brittle star traverse the rocks in search of food. So too do crustaceans, like this deep water lobster that was quick to find the bait in the cage at the end of our camera rig. But as is always the case, when feeding, many creatures in the ocean are vulnerable, and there are predators everywhere. This is a conger eel, and a species we've never recorded on these drops before. These eels are voracious nocturnal scavengers, and after initially going for the squid tentacles hanging from the cage, this eel decided the mackerel strapped to the top would be easier to tear apart. It seemed the lobster wasn't the only creature that thought it had better move elsewhere. Now, it's possible that this is conger cinereus, otherwise known as the grey or African longfin conger. But these eels are typically found much shallower and usually have faint barring or banding, so it's possible that this is a lesser-known conger species that's not well documented. Like other species of eel, congers have sharp conical teeth and rely on thrashing and rolling to tear off chunks of food. And this one made light work of the mackerel. Now, these eels are known to be solitary, but all of this commotion was bound to draw in more, and some of them are much larger. However, the congers took their time, giving way for other, slower-moving deep ocean creatures. I believe this is a species of carrier crab, a group of crabs known for carrying things around in their hind legs. This one appears to have picked up a hydroid, a colonial organism related to jellyfish and corals that packs a nasty sting. It's likely that this carrier crab opted for a hydroid to deter predators and also aid its camouflage, and it seems others apply the same logic. This one is much larger, and alongside the conger eel that continued to inspect the cage, easily convinced the smaller crab to move on. Whilst the larger carrier crab fed in peace, the conger was busy investigating everything else in the area, including the camera lens. Now, alongside the crabs and eels, many strange planktonic creatures drifted past the camera, likely attracted to the light, confusing it for the moon. Some of it is incredibly strange, like this thing. I have absolutely no idea what that is. After many laps and loops around the camera, the conger's interest in the bait eventually returned, and they made light work of the second half of the mackerel still strapped to the cage. As well as the congers, other eels also patrol these rocks at night. This is a high-fin moray eel, a species of moray we regularly record at these depths, despite the literature stating they only reside in shallower waters. Although they display some similarities, morays and congers are morphologically different. For example, whilst congers have pectoral fins, morays don't. Unfortunately, the moray was a little too late this time. The second camera was dropped on the sand, the favoured habitat of a number of different nocturnal creatures, like this dark-shouldered snake eel that had likely just emerged from its sandy burrow in search of small crustaceans walking along the ocean floor. However, this spot is also patrolled by other creatures that, although known to be rare and elusive, have become an incredibly common find on this channel, although on this drop there were two of them. These bizarre-looking creatures are called nautilus and are closely related to other cephalopods like octopus and squids. Whilst on previous drops we'd recorded them feeding on the bait, for some reason, this time round, they just seemed completely incapable of working out what they were doing, regularly bumping into each other, knocking their large shells on the camera rig and ocean floor, and jetting off as if spooked by something. They don't have very good eyesight though, and it's possible the concentration of scent coming from the bait cage was causing some confusion. Eventually, they managed to latch onto the cage, using their many tentacles to anchor themselves and probe around inside. Shortly afterwards, another species that I've not seen or recorded before appeared, the starry todo, a deep water member of the pufferfish family. Given these fish likely feed on crustaceans like their shallower water cousins, it showed little interest in our seafood offering. Now, nautilus have a very interesting anatomy. Their shells are divided into multiple internal chambers, with the animal living in the outermost one. The shell also provides buoyancy control via gas and fluid exchange, apparently. They also use a muscular tube called a siphon or hypernome for jet propulsion, allowing them to evade predators. This sits in and amongst up to 90 tentacles, although unlike the squid and octopus, the tentacles of the nautilus don't come with suckers. Like on the previous drop, after some time, the slower moving creatures also found the cage, and what appeared next is pretty nightmarish. This is likely a species of deep water spider crab, evidenced by its long spindly legs, compact carapace, and small oversized claw. After managing to climb on top of the cage, it spent a while picking away at the exposed mackerel before being forced to share it. When not in direct competition, these different species have no reason to challenge each other for the best feeding spots. Drop 3 told a similar story. Whilst this drop did introduce some interesting new creatures, like small shrimps and a wandering slip lobster, it was mainly dominated by another nautilus that spent an hour sat on top of a cage attempting to remove the squid's head. However, whilst this was going on, we did get a visit from another new creature, a deep water eel that snaked past along the sand. I'm not entirely sure what this species is. For these night drops, we'd made a few adjustments to the rig to help us better anchor the camera on the ocean floor in strong currents, and also prevent the light from deterring any photophobic creatures, like the hammerhead shark. It didn't help, of course, that the nautilus essentially morphed into the moon, with its bright white shell reflecting all of the light emitted from our rig, ruining our chances of drawing in more secretive species. Here's a more in-depth overview of the changes we've made.
Okay, so for those of you that have been following the deep rub journey, we've made a few modifications for these night setups. So first things first, we've added a little hood on the light. Hopefully this prevents anything from looking directly at the light. Second of all, to save my aging spine, we've got this much thinner Dyneema rope. This should massively reduce the drag underwater, so we can put way less weight on, which makes retrieving it a lot easier. And finally, we're trying some new baits out. That is a big, fat, fresh squid. Let's see what that draws in.
And down she goes.
The fourth drop also landed on the sand. And whilst it wasn't visited by any nautilus, it was swarmed by another group of cephalopods, the squids. I believe these are a species of flying squid, so named because of their ability to jump out of the water and glide. It's likely that the squids were attracted to the camera rig, not because of the bait, but because of all of the tiny zooplankton brought in by the lights. By ejecting ink, a mixture of melanin, mucus, enzymes, and water, they dart around in the black water, confusing both prey and predators. Although it seemed they too were confused, with many getting stuck in strange loops, spiraling around as if unable to control where they were going. This was evidenced by one individual that unfortunately found itself perfectly wedged into the small holes in the bait cage. After using its tentacles to find its footing and wriggle its soft body back out of the cage, all it could do to exclaim its trauma was do what squids do best. However, much more elusive predators patrol the sand at these depths. As expected, towards the end of the drop, yet another species of large deep ocean crab eventually arrived. However, after jumping on top of the cage, it was unfortunately bounced off after the camera rig became dislodged from the bottom. This movement was caused by large swell on the surface that was picking up the buoys we'd attached to the line. One of the biggest challenges we're facing at the moment is working out how to ensure we have enough buoyancy so we don't lose the camera rig if it's pulled into deep water, but not so much that it causes the camera rig to lose its footing when the waves pick up. What I know for sure though is dropping these camera rigs is tiring work. The next drop didn't provide much big fish action, but it did reveal other creatures that I've not seen before. Shortly after hitting the bottom, a school of incredibly reflective silverfish came in for a closer look. A large deep water urchin also moved into view, slowly traversing the sand. Unfortunately for it though, it soon had to change paths as the camera did a 180, pulled around by strong deep ocean currents. The lack of large ocean predators on this drop opened up an opportunity for small scavenging creatures to come in for a closer look, some of which were very bizarre. Large isopods walked over the sand, and various species of shrimp, some of which were very large, huddled around the cage. A wandering fireworm also emerged. These worms are armed with venomous bristles and are quick to pick up on the scent of decaying prey. The big fish did eventually return though. The penultimate drop also recorded some larger fish. A big dog-toothed tuna flashed past in the distance, and a very large creature moved through along the sand. I'm not 100% sure what this is, but given how it swims, it's likely a shark. But whilst whatever this was never came closer, the dark shadow we picked up the day before eventually decided to reveal itself on the final drop of this two-night mission.
It's 2 a.m. Morale is high, I think. Final pull to go. Let's do it.
Like drop one, the final drop was also in the rocks. After a shaky start, the camera rig eventually found its footing, and it wasn't long before the conger eels and large carrier crabs turned up to investigate the rig once more. We also recorded some other unusual species, including a familiar fish, a deep water antheus, that snuck in between the rocks, curious but cautious. Enormous fireworms also began patrolling, perhaps picking up on the various fishy scents coming out of the bait cage. Like the smaller fireworm we recorded, these larger individuals are likely also armed with thousands of venomous bristles. However, what appeared next was very unexpected. This is a deep water ray and appears to be a species of stingaree from the Eurylophus genus, a group of small-bodied stingrays with paddle-like tails. The problem, though, is that stingarees aren't really supposed to be in Indonesia, with almost all of them being endemic to Australia. The Java stingaree, once endemic to the neighbouring island of Java, is supposedly extinct, and another species, the Kai stingaree, is only known from two juveniles caught as bycatch in eastern Indonesia. So, what species is this one? After consulting with some of the biggest shark experts in the world, the answer is, we have no idea. Perhaps it's a massive range extension of an Australian variant. Perhaps it's a Java stingaree thought lost, or a mature Kai stingaree that we know little about. Or perhaps it's a species new to science. It's not every day you capture a creature that might rewrite part of the regional species record, and that's exactly what makes this project worth doing. I wonder what we'll find next. If you're new here, make sure to hit that subscribe button, and if you're in the mood for more ocean adventures, you'll probably like this video.